This is the Voyage Report podcast, where you get the scoop on travel. Now, the editor-in-chief of the Voyage Report, Mark Albert.
Greetings, fellow travelers, and welcome. Today, we're going to take you to the happiest place on Earth. Are you planning a trip to Disneyland or Disney World? We've got a self-described fanatic on the Magic Kingdom to share all kinds of insider tips and tricks. Linda Marquez is a panelist on the Disney Parks Moms panel for 2017, and she joins us today via Skype from her home near Denver. Linda, welcome to the Voyage Report podcast.
Hi, Mark. Thanks for having me.
Thanks for being here. So we start off our podcast with the same three questions for our guests. We're going to tweak it just a little bit today to go with our theme here. So first off, let me ask you, what has been your biggest discovery while at a Disney theme park?
I think my biggest discovery has been how easy it is to travel with a young child to Disney and at all. I think when I first had my daughter, she is now 4.5. I was very intimidated by traveling and, you know, getting on a plane and getting to the airport and all the transportation. And really going to Disneyland and the Walt Disney World Resort has made it so easy. And that's why we've chosen to go back several times a year, because there's really, in our mind, no easier place to travel with the whole family. So we didn't have to sacrifice our family vacations, and we can still have a wonderful time with a small child. And I love seeing the magic through her eyes. I love Disneyland. I loved it as a child, or I actually first went there as a teenager, and I still love it as much as an adult. But seeing the magic through your children's eyes and everything is real and pure, that you just can't buy that. That's priceless.
Linda, I think some of the parents listening on this podcast, their jaws just dropped when you said the easiest place to go with kids. So we know you're going to explain for us later in the podcast about just how easy it can be for those parents who may feel overwhelmed by planning a trip to Disneyland. So we'll get to that in a bit. What has been your favorite Disney amusement park that you've been to?
Well, I have traveled to the Disneyland Resort, of course, and also the Walt Disney World Resort several times. I've also been to Disneyland Paris. But I really have to say my favorite is Disneyland Park at the Disneyland Resort. It is Walt's original theme park. You can actually, you know, walk where Walt walked, because Disney World wasn't built, unfortunately, until after he died. So Disneyland was really his park. And there's so much history there. A lot of the classic attractions that were open on the first day are still running in operation today. And it just holds so much special, so many special memories to me that I really love that original park.
Now I'm trying to think back here. Original ones would be what? The Haunted Mansion and the Pirates of the Caribbean, maybe?
Yes, and there's a few of the smaller ones. And of course, if I try to rattle them off now, I'd probably get them wrong. But there are so many that you can look online, and they'll actually say classic attraction that opened in 1955 with the park. And Pirates of the Caribbean is one of my all-time favorite rides, and I love that attraction.
Oh, isn't that great? And we normally ask our guests the next place they're traveling to. So we'll ask you, what's the next Disney park you're traveling to?
We're actually planning a trip back to Disneyland Resort in April. We just returned. Actually, no, I forgot. I have one coming up in January. we are actually reuniting with my 2017 Disney Parks Moms panelists. Our whole class is meeting back up at the Walt Disney World Resort the beginning of January, which is marathon weekend at the Disney World Resort. So we are all getting together. A lot of my classmates are running in the several different races that they have. I am a cheer squad member. I don't run, but I'm going to be there to cheer them on and to reunite with all these great, great friends that I've made through being on the Moms panel.
Well, Linda, I must confess, I've only been to Walt Disney World in Florida once. It was in college at USC, and we marched down Main Street. We were there for the USC versus Florida State game, I believe it was, and we had a parade there, so that was quite memorable as well. So, Linda, we're right in the middle of a holiday season as we're speaking, just after Thanksgiving and before Christmas and Hanukkah and New Year's. Lots of families may be going to a Disney theme park to celebrate. So when someone asks you for advice and they've never been to a Disney park, how do you even begin to start giving them advice?
I would say, you know, planning is key, especially at the Walt Disney World Resort, where dining reservations are made 6 months in advance.
Oh my
and
gosh.
Even at the Disneyland Resort, where you can make dining reservations 60 days in advance. And during the holidays, it's a very popular time to visit either park, either theme park, either Disney World or Disneyland. So planning is key, even if that just means, you know, looking through the Disneyland or Disney World websites to search attractions, to make your must-do list, to find places to eat. It's really going to go a long way once you get to the parks and realize that there's so much fun to be had, so you know exactly where to go to next. And of course, there's lots and lots of resources out there. My top picks are, of course, the actual Disneyland and Disney World websites. The Disney Parks blog also has great information. Plus, they are the first ones to release any news, news or information, things that are coming to the parks, things that are new this year. And also, of course, come ask the Disney Parks Moms Panel if you have any questions, which is DisneyParksMomsPanel.com. You can submit a question about anything and get a personalized response, because we have a panel of moms and dads that have probably seen and done it all over the years. So no matter what your question, we probably have an answer for you.
And I didn't even know that this mom's panel existed until recently when I saw you give an interview. I think it was to Budget Travel. So what is the mom's panel? And you mentioned dads as well. Just describe a little bit more about that, please.
Sure. It is an online resource. You can find a link to it if you go to the help page on either the Disney World or the Disneyland Resort website, but you can also go directly to our site, DisneyParksMomsPanel.com, and there you will find thousands upon thousands of answers that the moms panelists have answered throughout the years. So you can type in a subject, pick your park, whichever park you're going to, and you can search for answers. And if you can't find what you need, you can submit a question and get a personalized response, usually back in a couple of days. And this could be about Disneyland, Disney World, if you're a Disney Vacation Club member, Disney Cruise Line, or if you're participating in any of the Run Disney events. We have panelists that specialize in all of those areas. Plus, we also have panelists that speak Spanish, French, and Portuguese, that they can help our international travelers as well.
And just to be clear here, this is free, right? So this advice, when you submitted a question, there's no cost.
Absolutely free, yes. And you can come back and ask as many questions as you like.
There's no limit. I love that. I love that. Now, of course, when we speak about Disneyland, and I'm from the Los Angeles area, these days it includes California Adventure Park, the Downtown Disney, which is free to walk around, not in the actual park itself, but right next to it. You've got a series of hotels and spas, and you, in fact, recently retweeted a post about new features coming to Downtown Disney in 2018. So for those who may not have been since Downtown Disney opened, what, 5, 8 years ago or so, what is it and what's coming?
Yeah, so the Downtown Disney District at the Disneyland Resort is a shopping and dining area, no ticket required. It's outside the parks where you can enjoy like world-class dining and some amazing shopping, including, of course, several Disney stores. World of Disney is located there. It's a huge store full of just about every type of Disney merchandise you could ever want. As well as some other interesting shops. Like there is, my favorite is the Wonderground Gallery, which is Disney inspired art. They have different artists that come in and actually, create things in the store, which is really amazing. And it's also the gateway to the Disneyland Resort hotels. And something that's going to be kicking off next year is a construction on a brand new 700 room hotel that will be kind of this anchor at the Downtown Disney District. The monorail platform is going to be located inside the hotel, and there's going to have restaurants, an upper level lounge where you can view fireworks from the hotel. The ground level will have more shops and restaurants. It's not slated to open until 2021, but the construction will start next year. And just from the concept art that's been posted on the Disney Parks blog, it looks incredible. It's really going to change what that area looks like, and kind of the whole, it's going to tie the whole area together.
Listeners, we're going to be asking Linda for her money-saving tips for visiting Disneyland throughout the podcast. So be sure to listen all the way to the end. And we're going to ask her about Disney freebies and how to snag those for your family. Everybody loves freebies. She has some that you have probably never heard of, so we're going to hear those from her later on. So, Linda, how do you even begin to plan a trip to Disneyland for a family? I think a lot of families, as I mentioned, especially those with young kids, may just be overwhelmed by all the attractions, all the things you can do. So how do you recommend someone to begin planning the visit? What's your battle plan?
I like to watch videos. I'm a very visual learner. So there's some great resources out there. We have several videos on the Disney Parks Moms Panel website, but there is also a site called DisneyPlanning.com that after you put in a few bits of contact information, you can view several planning videos. They'll give you quick overviews on attractions, hotels, the different parks, different dining options. So it really gives you a nice scope of what you can look forward to on your visit. From there, I really suggest looking into vacation packages. This is going to be the easiest way for families to kind of book everything all together. You can get your park tickets, your hotel accommodations, and you can even add things like character dining into that, transportation from the airport. So really, it's kind of a one-stop shop, which really, I think, makes it easy for families. You know, they don't have to do several transactions at once. It's all together. And one of the great things about vacation packages is it only requires a $200 down payment when you book. And then you don't have to pay it off until 30 days before your arrival date. So it kind of helps. That helps with me to plan my budget. And so I like to make payments over time, obviously much easier than making a large payment all at once. And you can determine what those payments are and when you make them, as long as it's paid off 30 days in advance. So if you have, if you know you want to go maybe next summer, maybe consider looking into vacation packages now so you can plan those payments out over several months.
Linda, do you ever just show up at Disneyland without planning?
It's very rare. I am a huge, huge planner. I'm always planning my next trip. But Disneyland Resort is very much a locals park. And that's exactly what a lot of people do. They show up, they have annual passes, they just show up and they go have fun. And you can absolutely do that. You can, I mean, they're designed that way. You walk in and the magic starts from the moment you enter the park and head to your favorite attraction, or just start wandering through and see where you end up. And you can have fun whether you've planned for months or whether you just shown up that day.
Well, it's funny that you mentioned that. As a Los Angeles area resident growing up, my sister and I could choose to go to Disneyland for our birthday gift every year. My parents gave us that option. And it was expensive back then, too. And so we knew that it was a real treat to be able to go once a year. If I remember correctly, I'm racking my brain here. If I recall correctly, the tickets were $25 a piece. So it was $100 for a family of four. That didn't count, of course, food, toys, everything else. Today, I noticed that one-day ticket prices are between $97 and $124 per person, depending on the date, how popular it is. Listeners, Disney no longer has just one price across the board. It fluctuates. So for a family of four on a peak day, which is most of December I was looking at, that could be $496 before you even walk in the door. So, Linda, do you think that Disneyland has been priced out of the range for some families that want to take everyone to go there for a treat?
It's definitely possible. To me, I think it's worth every penny. The memories we've made are priceless, and I can't put a price tag on the magic and the memories that we've experienced there. But like I said, if you plan ahead, there's ways to help kind of ease that cost, especially if you purchase multi-day tickets, because the price gets cheaper the longer the ticket that you buy. Or like I said, book a vacation package, then it's only $200 at the beginning. And really, if you're making memories with your family, I think it's worth every penny.
So that's one money-saving tip to book a multi-day pass. And I know we've got several other money-saving tips, lots of them coming up through this podcast, listeners. Now, I am a reporter, so I had to do research for this interview, and I turned to the biggest Disney fan I know, which is my sister. She lives in Los Angeles. She now goes all the time. She's got one of those yearly passes that you were talking about. We even celebrated her wedding there. So she was schooling me on some of the latest happenings here at Disney. She mentioned that a lot of activities revolve around food. These character breakfasts, these tea parties, pool parties, dessert parties. What do you think is best for kids if you want to plan something around food?
Oh my gosh, the food at the Disneyland Resort is phenomenal. I continue to be surprised at how wonderful it is. And not just at these fabulous table service restaurants, but the quick service. I mean, it's really gone above and beyond. For kids, character dining is amazing. My favorite character meal is the Minnie and Friends breakfast at the Plaza Inn, which is inside the Disneyland park. It is a breakfast buffet. Basically, everything you could ever want is available on this breakfast buffet. But the characters you meet here, you meet so many, and they're different. You'll meet Minnie when you arrive. But last time we were there, we met Chip, Dale, Captain Hook. We've met Rafiki, the fairy godmother, and it was just one after the other. And seeing my child's eyes light up every single time a character came by our table was amazing. And it's a big time saver. If we wanted to, you know, wait in line and meet these different characters throughout the park, that might take us quite a bit of time. But here they all came right to our table at this character breakfast.
And so how much are those character breakfasts?
They range in price, which are online. Somewhere around, you know, in the 40 per person range, I want to say, but check the website for the most up-to-date pricing.
Got it. And so for families with little kids, are the daycare offerings worth it? I think Grand Californian has a daycare room at Disneyland. Disney Cruises have kids areas. Have you ever used the daycare offerings?
Well, there used to be one at the Grand Californian, but I believe it closed last year. It used to be Pinocchio's Workshop. So they no longer have any on-site childcare facilities at the Disneyland Resort. However, at the Walt Disney World Resort, they do have a few of those kids clubs, which are excellent, especially if the parents want to go out and have a really nice meal. We toured one as part of my Disney Parks Moms panel training at the Polynesian Hotel. And I mean, they had activities of all kinds. Dress up. They had arts and crafts. For the older kids, they had video game stations. And the prices were extremely reasonable. Some of them even included feeding the children dinner. So I think they're excellent. At the Disneyland Resort, your options are more from third-party vendors providing babysitting services at your hotel room. Or do what I do, travel with family and take turns. Let my daughter go off with her aunt or her grandmother while we go off and ride some of the bigger roller coasters or have dinner.
Now, you mentioned earlier one of the new hotels coming to downtown Disney. Do you personally stay in a Disney hotel on site, or do you stay at some of these off-brand, off-site hotels? I would imagine some of the off-site hotels would be cheaper, but then again, you don't get direct access or perhaps early hours at the park.
True. I always stay at a Disneyland Resort hotel because I love the extra magic hour perk, which, again, only comes with staying at a Disneyland Resort hotel, which is 1 hour earlier than general admission opening to one park each day of your stay. But there are a lot of what they call good neighbor hotels, and the Disneyland Resort is surrounded by them. So there is a hotel to fit every budget at the Disneyland Resort. And you can book those good neighbor hotels right through the Disneyland Resort website as well. And a lot of them are within walking distance to the parks, or they offer free shuttles, and some even have continental breakfast and other perks too. So definitely worth checking out all of your options when booking a trip.
We're speaking with Linda Marquez, a panelist of the Disney Parks Moms Panel for 2017. She answers hundreds and hundreds of questions about Disney on social media. Linda, I think you had mentioned you're up to over 700 or something.
Yes, I think my total now is getting close to 750 so far this year.
We're adding to that here on the podcast. Listeners, you can follow her on Twitter at blurbs43, B as in boy, L-U-R, B as in boy, S as in Sam, 43. And a little later on, Linda is going to tell us about Disney freebies. You may not have heard of before, so you're going to want to keep listening for that. Now, Linda, one thing that is free is the Disney app. Now, is that just a glorified promotion, or can we actually do stuff, get information in that app that will make the visit go smoother?
Oh, the Disneyland app is going to be your best tool when planning a visit and also while you're in the parks. You can make dining reservations in advance on the app. You can look up attraction wait times, which are current. So once you're in the park, if you're looking, you know, which attraction should we head to next, you bring up the app and say, oh, well, Buzz Lightyear Astro Blasters only has a 10-minute wait. Let's head there next. The other thing you can do is take advantage of Disney's MaxPass service. This is an upgrade to your ticket, which allows you to make fast passes on the app for everyone in your party from anywhere in the park. The Disneyland Resort still currently has the traditional FastPass system, which means you walk to a FastPass distribution kiosk near the attraction, insert your park ticket, and a FastPass reminder ticket is distributed. If you want to save yourself some steps and some time, you can upgrade to the MaxPass option on the app and grab those fast passes quickly and easily from anywhere in the park. I used this on a past visit, and it was astonishing how much time that saved me. And the Disneyland app is also really good for folks heading there for the first time that may not know where things are or how to get around, because it has the great map view. It'll show you where you are in the park, and you can help you navigate to get around both Disneyland Park and Disney California Adventure Park. It is an amazing tool, hands down.
All right, so for those of us who may not be as familiar with this, for rookies or those who haven't been, let's just back up and talk about fast passes and max passes. What is a fast pass? The difference between the two. I know you mentioned you can upgrade to the max pass. How much does that cost? Just lay it out for us.
Sure. Oh, yes, absolutely. So the fast pass, the Disney fast pass system is what helps you skip the lines at some of these larger attractions that tend to have longer wait times. What it means is you go either to a FastPass distribution kiosk, or if you're using the app, you can get a FastPass with a return time. And when that time comes up, you can head back to the attraction, enter through the FastPass queue, and almost walk right onto the ride without having to wait however long the posted limit is for standby. So the traditional FastPass system is included with your theme park ticket. Anyone can use that without any extra additional cost. The Disney MaxPass system is currently an upgrade available for $10 per ticket per day. And you can purchase that through the Disneyland app. And like I said, that allows you to select your fast passes on your app from anywhere in the park. So it's going to save you a lot of time, and you can do it. So for instance, I could pull a fast pass for an attraction, ride that attraction while I'm waiting to get on the attraction vehicle, select another fast pass for another attraction. So I can go from one attraction to the other all day long, riding my favorite rides with minimal wait.
And the max passes that you upgrade, what's the cost on that?
The max pass is $10 per day per ticket.
Got it. And that allows you to save even more time.
Absolutely. Yes. And that is, they slated that as an introductory price. So that is the current price as of today. So always check the Disneyland website for most up-to-date pricing for your trip.
So as you're going through Disneyland, what are some tips that you like to tell people about the park? We'll leave the freebies for the end, but what are some tips that we can use to make our visit go even smoother?
Sure. I like to start early. If you have any early admission options available to you, such as the Extra Magic Hour if you're staying at a Disneyland Resort hotel, or Magic Morning if you have a 3-day or longer park ticket. You get one Magic Morning at Disneyland Park. Like I said, gets you in an hour before general admission. Start early. The crowds are low in the morning, and if you're traveling during the hot summer months, the temperatures are pretty low too, so that makes it more comfortable. And make a list of your must-do attractions and prioritize those, because there's so much to do and explore. You don't want to miss a favorite. And the other tip I like to tell people is to keep your eyes open. One of my favorite things about the Disneyland Resort is that many characters freely roam the parks. So you never know who you actually just might bump into walking through Fantasyland. We've come across Peter Pan and Captain Hook. So many people that you don't have to necessarily wait in line to see. They're wandering around. And I think that's actually kind of a special magical touch about the Disneyland Resort.
Now, there have been some drastic changes to the landscape at Disneyland in recent years. We've got Star Wars Land under construction. There's Pixar Pier, I think. How are those changes affecting the experience of families with kids and the rest of us?
Actually, I haven't found that they've impacted the parks that much. There was some closures when Star Wars Galaxy's Edge was beginning construction, but that's been at least over a year now. And really, that construction is kind of outside of the park at this moment. You can walk up to where the entrances to the new Star Wars Galaxy's Edge park or land will be. But really, it's not affecting your flow of the park or which attractions are closed at this time. Really, it's just going to be this exciting new addition to the park once it opens. Pixar Pier is heading our way next summer at Disney California Adventure Park. And there will be a few attractions that will close for refurbishment in January. And they will reopen in summer when the new Pixar Pier retheming is complete.
And what is Pixar Pier going to be?
So there's an area right now called Paradise Pier over in Disney California Adventure Park that includes the area where the big Mickey Fun Wheel is and a few other attractions. That's going to be completely rethemed to be to live and breathe Pixar. So what is now California Screamin', which is a roller coaster, will be rethemed to the Incredicoaster, which is from the Incredibles movie. And then Mickey's Fun Wheel. Each of the individual carts of Mickey's Fun Wheel will be rethemed to have a different Pixar character on each of those carts as well. And currently, there's a Toy Story Midway Mania attraction in this area. That will remain. And so the rest of the area surrounding that will be more Pixar central.
And of course, every parent knows Pixar from their number one animation films that seem to come every year. Now, yeah. Star Wars Land is due to open in 2019 in Anaheim and at Disney's Hollywood Studios in Disney World in Orlando, I believe. Is that correct?
That's correct, yes. And I think it will open in Disneyland first. We get to have I don't know by how much, but they did say that it's going to open in Disneyland first in 2019.
The force is strong with Disneyland. It'll cover about 14 acres. Bob Chapek, the chairman of Disney's Parks Division, said, quote, "This is the most ambitious land we've built to date." And Disney bought Lucasfilm in 2012 for $4 billion, which has now led to all these theme park additions and the new Star Wars films, the latest of which I'm looking forward to is The Last Jedi, which comes out shortly. What do we know about Star Wars Land? I mean, I assume it's going to be an immersive experience.
Oh, you can bet on it. I mean, if you have ever experienced Cars Land in Disney California Adventure Park, it blows my mind how completely, perfectly themed that is from top to bottom. Star Wars Land, which is now called Star Wars Galaxy's Edge, will take that, I think, to a whole new level. It is going to be a completely immersive, a new planet, I believe, that Star Wars fans aren't introduced to yet. It's going to feature at least one attraction where you can kind of pilot the Millennium Falcon, I believe. There's probably going to be a great dining location there, and you can bet every Star Wars fan from across the world are going to want to experience these parks.
Oh, my goodness. I think I was Darth Vader in third grade, if I recall correctly.
Nice.
Yes, so I've been a Star Wars fan for a long time. So if we're going to a Disney park, you are fond of saying that we need to do certain things the night before we go. Like what?
Well, I think you want to plan your days and know exactly what time you're going to get at the parks to the next morning, know when the park hours are, and kind of have a plan of attack, if you will. So you know what attractions you're heading to first. For instance, if you know that you want to ride Peter Pan's flight, that is where you want to head to first thing the next morning. The day before is always filled with so much excitement at our house. My daughter can barely sleep because she's bouncing off the walls. And I really think it's good to get a great night's sleep because it's going to be a lot of walking and a lot of fun that first day in the parks.
And what about packing? What should we pack? And does Disney prohibit us from bringing outside food or snacks?
No, and that is actually one of the number one questions we get asked at the Disney Parks Moms panel is whether you can bring in snacks and water bottles into the park. And the answer is absolutely within reason. If you're going to bring a whole picnic lunch, it's probably best to keep that in a cooler in a locker and enjoy it at one of the picnic tables outside of Disneyland Park. But if you are visiting, especially with young children, I always come with a backpack full of snacks. My daughter is always hungry, it seems, as soon as we get in a line for an attraction. So it's always nice to have a little munchie on hand. And water bottles are key, especially if you're traveling when it's warm. You need to stay hydrated, so always bring water bottles with you. You can refill those through the day. They have several drinking fountains available for that. And I like to have a few of those snacks that I pack for my daughter as well, because you definitely burn off a lot of energy touring the parks.
Absolutely. And I love the tip about bringing the water bottle because even going through an airport, a lot of people don't think about this. You can bring an empty water bottle through security and simply fill it up on the other side. So I love that tip of always having a water bottle and simply refilling it throughout the parks. And now, when you get there, you suggest looking for hidden Mickeys. I'm very intrigued. What are hidden Mickeys? And give us a few clues.
Sure. So hidden Mickeys are basically any type of three circular patterns that come together to kind of form a Mickey head with the two ears. And these are hidden all throughout the parks. There's obviously many obvious Mickeys that we know that they did there, that they did on purpose, but the hidden Mickeys are what you might find in places as random as in the sidewalk concrete, or on a wall, or hidden in certain attractions. My tip is if you see any circular design anywhere, is to take a look, and I bet that you will find a hidden Mickey somewhere. My favorite one is inside the Haunted Mansion attraction in the dining room scene. If you take a look at the table, there are usually three plates set on the table that will form the shape of a Mickey head.
Oh my goodness. Now, as a reporter, we're supposed to be observant, but of course, I never, ever noticed any hidden Mickey at Disneyland. So that tells you how observant I've been when I'm there enjoying it. That's
And
fantastic.
I'm the same way. And it's my daughter that actually usually points them out to me. You know, they spend so much time in school recognizing shapes and patterns, and she loves searching those out at the parks.
Now, we are speaking here in the month of December. So, if your family is going in December, did I see that you can write and drop off letters to Santa at Disneyland? How does that work?
So, yeah, there are several mailboxes that are actually real postal mailboxes throughout the Disneyland Resort that you can drop in any type of mail or postcard into these mailboxes. Just remember to bring your own stamp. I don't think they sell them in the park, so bring your own stamp, get a postcard, or write a letter to Santa, and it'll come straight from Disneyland.
Oh, fantastic. Now, listeners, it is time to ask Linda for perhaps her most valuable tips, how to get your Disney freebies. Did you even know there are freebies? Well, Linda reminds us not to miss out. So, what kind of freebies are you talking about, and how do we claim them?
Sure. Well, the first one, especially for families traveling with young children, if your kids are under the age of 3, they are guests of Mickey, which means they do not need a theme park ticket to enter either Disneyland Park or Disney California Adventure Park. So that's a big freebie right there if you have little ones.
That's a huge money-saving tip.
Absolutely. The next is to get a complimentary pin or button. These are available in a few different varieties. If you are going to Disneyland, it's your first visit, you can get a first visit pin. If you're celebrating your birthday or something special, you can stop by City Hall in Disneyland Park or the Chamber of Commerce in Disney California Adventure Park. Sometimes they also have them at a little carts throughout if you're walking down Main Street or Buena Vista, but those are the two main places. Ask for a free button and they will be happy to give you one and write your name on it for you. So it's kind of fun, especially if it's your birthday. We always recommend to stop by and get a birthday pin because cast members will see these throughout the day and they love telling, especially little kids, happy birthday throughout the parks. And it just kind of brings extra joy to the day. My next freebie is a personal favorite. If you go to the Ghirardelli Chocolate and Soda Shop, I believe that's what it's called. I should probably get the correct name. If you
I
go to
love chocolate, so
Ghirardelli's,
I'll go no matter. I'll just go for the chocolate, but.
yes, if you go to Ghirardelli's, which is in Disney California Adventure Park, you walk in and you are handed a free chocolate square. These sometimes correspond with the season. So we were there in fall once, and it was pumpkin spice chocolate. During the holidays right now, you might get kind of a candy cane flavored chocolate square. But hey, any chocolate square, especially a free one, I am there. So take a walk through, and hey, while you're there, order a delicious sundae or a shake, but get your free chocolate square. In the same area as Ghirardelli's is the sourdough Bowden's Bakery tour, where you can walk in, see how the sourdough is actually made, but you get a free little taste of the delicious sourdough bread as you walk through.
Wow.
And then finally, may not be too exciting, but since we were just talking about water bottles, one of the freebies that you can get are free cups of ice water at any quick service restaurant. Just walk right up, ask for a free cup of ice water, and they will be happy to hand it to you to refill your water bottles or just for a quick sip of water throughout the day. It's so important. And a nice, cool, refreshing drink for free.
Oh, my goodness. You are definitely the expert because I've never heard of any of these. my goodness, not only do they save you money, but also make you feel really special and get some freebies as you're going through the park. What are some other money-saving tips or just tips that you love to use for your family that you've learned throughout the years that you can share with our listeners?
Sure. One of the best places to check is the offers and discounts page of the Disneyland Resort website. This is where they list all of their current promotions. They have promotions for hotel room stays, as well as park tickets and vacation packages. So check that page often as different promotions are added throughout the year. Also, if you visit often, become an annual passport holder, or even look into it, because the annual passport holders, they get special discounts on merchandise and dining. They also get access to special events earlier than the rest of the population, like Mickey's Halloween party. They get access to buy those tickets before the rest of us. So becoming an annual passport holder really is an excellent deal, not only if you're visiting the parks throughout the year, but also the added bonus of these extra discounts. And if you are a military member, there are really great discounts on theme park tickets and hotel stays at the Disneyland Resort if you're a member of the military.
Uh-huh. That could be very valuable, obviously, Absolutely. To any service member. So I understand then you probably never pay full price, do you? You either go on to the discounts page or you know all these freebies. I would imagine that in your trips you save a lot of money as well.
It's definitely worth looking into. Sometimes, you know, the timing doesn't work out quite right to take advantage of a certain promotion I'm eyeing, but I at least try to see what's out there. They really try to make it as accessible for everybody, and different promotions are added throughout the year. So it's definitely something I keep an eye on, and if a great one comes along, you know I'm planning a trip.
Well, tickets are no longer $25 a piece like when I was a kid, so it definitely helps to save every dollar you can. Linda Marquez is a panelist on the Disney Parks Mom Panel for 2017 and a self-described Disney fanatic, and she has proved it on this podcast. My goodness, such great, great tips and advice. You can follow her and ask her for advice on Twitter at blurbs43, B as in boy, L-U-R, B as in boy, S as in Sam, 43, where she's so far answered more than 700 questions this year alone. Linda, thank you so much for being on the Voyage Report podcast and sharing all of your knowledge. I feel like lots of our listeners were taking copious notes as you were talking. We really appreciate it.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for having me. I love talking about Disneyland.
Listeners, what are your best tips for visiting a Disney theme park? Let us know by rating this podcast, giving us a review, and sharing it on social media. We have guests every week talking about travel news and trends, so be sure to subscribe to our podcast. We'd sure appreciate your review. It helps bring more awareness to our journalism and original content. And if you have an idea for our future guest on our podcast, please reach out at voyagereport.com and let us know. Thanks for joining us today. I'm Mark Albert. Bon voyage.
You've been listening to the Voyage Report podcast. Get the scoop on travel at voyagereport.com.